God himself will be with them. He will wipe every tear from their eyes. Death will be no more. Mourning and crying and pain will be no more. For the first things have passed away. Welcome to the first church in Sterling, which is made sacred today by the spirit of love and community that you bring as you come to celebrate and honor the life of Charlotte Gildutis. This is the first funeral that we have had in this sanctuary since we have shut down for the COVID-19 pandemic, since we closed our building. And it is appropriate to honor Charlotte Gildutis first, isn't it? As she is our longest-term member at 103 years, a member of First Church in Sterling. Right, Rana? Who better to celebrate this morning at our first service inside our sanctuary? So, I have a couple of things to just remind you of. Gathering in the Spirit of Jesus right now means wearing our mask to protect our neighbors, so we will keep our mask on at all times, even the leader of the service. I don't know if you saw this on Twitter, but there was a Japanese roller coaster ride in Japan that had a sign that asked people to scream inside their hearts during COVID-19. And so I'm hoping that you all rise in body and spirit to join in the hymns, but to sing inside your heart. Can you do that? Okay, good. We're going to sing quietly inside our hearts. We also want you to know that you will leave the sanctuary immediately following this service. The funeral home directors will tell you when it is your time to leave. The family will stay a little longer, and then we will join together again for burial service at Oak Hill Cemetery on the left-hand side, not hillside. We gather as people of many faith traditions and some of no faith tradition. Wherever you are on life's journey, you are welcome here. God, too, is among us, reminding us of words trustworthy and true, that even death cannot conquer life. God makes God's home among us this morning. Blessed are all those who mourn, for they will be comforted. God will wipe every tear from our eyes. And indeed, today we mourn the loss of Charlotte Gildutis. We also come together as a community to do the important work of witnessing the long, long life of this smart, strong, vivacious, tenacious woman. Charlotte was a teacher, a gardener, a singer, a violinist, a sewer, a rug hooker, a skier, a cake decorator, an animal lover, a church pillar. Charlotte was a friend, a wife, a sister, a mother, an aunt, a grandmother, a great-grandmother, and she was beloved by so many, particularly her daughters, Gail and Barbara, and their husbands, Dina and Bill, and her four grandchildren, and her four great-grandchildren, and her beloved Kitty, Lucy, and her dear cousins, Roberta and Nancy, and her dedicated heart friend caretaker, Vivian, and many nieces and nephews. During this time, we can face our grief and our loss because we are held in this space, a safe sanctuary of family, friends, and the Spirit of God, which is upon us all. Here we are free to think what must be thought and feel what must be felt. Whatever feelings you are experiencing here, you are free to let it out. Let it out in your tears, let it out in your prayers, let it out even in your laughter. This is the important work of grieving and letting go. It's difficult to say goodbye to someone who was loved the way Charlotte was loved, who lived through two world wars, who seemingly would live forever. life of a woman who touched our lives in so many ways, with memories, with meaning, and most of all, with love. Please rise in body or in spirit and sing inside your hearts our first hymn in the garden.
A reading from the Gospel according to John. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Believe in God. Believe also in me. In my Father's house, there are many dwelling places. If it were not so, would I have told you that I go to prepare a place for you? And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and will take you to myself, so that where I am, you may be also. A reading from the Gospel according to Matthew. When Jesus saw the crowds, he went up the mountain, and after he sat down, his disciples came to him. Then he began to speak and taught them, saying, "Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will receive mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven." I ask you all now to join me in the reading of the unison reading. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside still waters. He restores my soul. He leads me in right path for his name's sake. Even though I walk through the darkest valley, I fear no evil, for you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever.
Thank you.
They just taught me the song and I don't remember it, so I'm not going to sing it. I'm just going to speak it. I'm sorry, Barbara. Father, we thank you for the night and for the pleasant morning light, for rest and food and loving care, and all that makes the world so fair. Help us to do the things we should, to be to others kind and good in all we do in work and play, to grow more loving every day. Amen. Charlotte Patton Gildutis, age 103, passed away peacefully at her home on Friday, October 2nd. Charlotte was the daughter of the late Charles W. and Rachel H. Patton. Charlotte was the second of Charlie Patton's five pretty daughters. Her parents thought she might be a boy, and so they hoped that she would become her father's namesake before she was born. When she arrived as a girl, they named her Charlotte instead of Charles. Charlotte was raised in Sterling by a hard-working father and a strong, courageous mother. Rachel, Charlotte's mother, was a warm and intelligent schoolhouse teacher here in Sterling, a before-her-time kind of woman. Rachel was the first woman to drive a car in Sterling, Massachusetts. The family lived in a house at the top of Maple Street here in Sterling. When Charlotte was 11 in May of 1928, the original house burned to the ground. Rachel got all five of her girls out. She also got out the couch and the chairs, which she threw out the window. And Charlotte still had them in her house on Charles Patton Drive when she died. After the fire, Sterling got town water because they didn't have enough water in town to put it out. So we have that fire to thank for our town's water system. Charlotte graduated from Leominster High School and earned her BS in Nutrition and Home Economics at Framingham State Teachers College. She remembers being sent home from the classroom when the winds from the hurricane of 1938 kicked up and sent her home. She was famously a witness of the church steeple toppling off of the first church during the Sterling Fair that same day, although it is in dispute whether she was the one at the top of the Ferris wheel or whether it was her sister. Charlotte met her husband of 63 years, Ed, while teaching home economics at Athol Junior High School. She and Ed met at the ski shop where he worked. They were both skiers. A former May Queen at Framingham State, Charlotte was as beautiful as she was intelligent. Charlotte's roommate asked Ed if he would help her out with fitting her skis, and that was when he saw her. Though he was dating someone else at the time, I hear, he knew about the minute that he saw her that Charlotte was the woman he would marry. Ed was into photography and took a lot of beautiful pictures of Charlotte when they were dating. I think you can see some of them on the video. She looked like a centerfold model. She was so beautiful. Blue, sparkling eyes, dim curls that lit up the room. Ed was stationed in the Army Air Corps in Niagara Falls in 1943. So before he left for war, Charlotte asked him to marry her. "You're going to be overseas. Let's just get hitched," Charlotte said. She was a no-nonsense kind of get-down-to-business lady. And they got married in Niagara Falls that year very quickly. When Ed returned from the war, they lived briefly in a brown house by Lake Washakum. And they built the house Charlotte died in on Charles Patton in 1953. So she lived in that house from 1953 until 2020. Isn't that amazing? She was so proud of that house, I know, because I visited her there, and the memories contained therein. Together, Charlotte and Ed loved cross-country skiing, antiquing, gardening, vegetables and flowers, and geology. They had a huge garden. They adored the Sterling Fair, where they entered all kinds of vegetables, blueberries, beans, and tomatoes. They loved antiquing and collecting their antiques. They loved their two daughters, Barbara and Gail. Charlotte worked hard. After the kids weren't so little anymore, Charlotte worked outside the home. She was a substitute teacher at the high school. She worked at Fishburg State. She worked for the healthcare department. And Charlotte and Ed loved Sterling so much, they rarely left. The family vacationed here in Sterling on Lake Washakum, on a plot of land there. Ed worked at Mass Electric as a draftsman, and he was also, like Charlotte, a very hard worker. Even in retirement, he worked in the orchards picking apples. Ed died in 2006 at 88 years old, so Charlotte lived 14 years without him. Private and proud, her children only saw her cry once that they could remember when an iron fell on her toe. But they know how much she missed him. As a mom, Charlotte wasn't the type to be lovey-dovey, her daughter Barbara said, but we always knew she loved us. It was something in the air. She took care of business, and she cooked for them. Charlotte was a stickler. After Ed went, her son-in-law Bill said he would help her with her financial stuff. Once he did a reconciliation of the accounts and was off by 6 cents, and he never heard the end of it. Charlotte was also talented. Her hobbies included gardening and playing the violin, and reupholstering antique furniture, and sewing, and knitting, and rug hooking, and cake decorating. In her youth, she enjoyed skiing, and she also loved animals and had many cats and dogs throughout her life. Having lived for 103 long years, Charlotte also lived through a lot of personal loss. She was the last surviving sister for a very long time with 5 girls. She lost her 4th sister, Patty, when Patty was just 36, to cancer. She lost her 3rd sister, Betty, when she was 50, to breast cancer. She lost her oldest sister, Emily, who lived in Washington State when she was 75. Her youngest sister, Peggy, was living in Florida. They were the last two, and she died in her 80s. Charlotte was a pillar of this church, the first church in Sterling, her lifelong home. A member for 103 years, 47 of those in the church choir. Charlotte Patton Gildutis has been described by the people of this congregation as caring, determined, talented, soft-spoken, and genteel. My choir buddy. A wonderful storyteller, a remarkable, strong-willed woman, a beautiful soul. Charlotte was a great saint of the church, and she is owed my and our endless and eternal gratitude. We need the saints, though in a world of sound bites and short attention spans and 24-hour news cycles, we sometimes forget that we do. Two of the most oft-repeated phrases in our scriptures are, do not be afraid and remember. We are doomed without our memory. And Charlotte, now like our saints, hallow these hallways of this sacred institution. They are the very foundation of this building and these people, and they haunt us in the very best way. The saints built both the walls of this church and the covenants that we promise to one another. The stories we tell are their stories, Charlotte's stories. People like Charlotte are the reason we have been coming together to this church in unity and love for hundreds of years. We live because of them. So today we must pick up where Charlotte left off by following her example. Our work as the church is to become the saints. The Beatitudes, the scripture we read this morning from the Gospel of Matthew, means in Latin a condition or statement of blessedness. We read Jesus' Beatitudes on All Saints Day every year, which is coming up in 2 weeks. Because saints are just imperfect people who lived in the spirit of this blessedness. We need to look no further than the Beatitudes for our own instruction book, for our own sainthood, for our own understanding of how we can be more like Charlotte. The Beatitudes is the manual for becoming saints because it highlights the clash between the world as it is and the world as it should be. The world says the more stuff you have, the happier you'll be. But Jesus says, blessed are you whose wallet is empty, and you whose credit card is maxed out. And blessed are those of you who don't know where your next meal will come from. Blessed are you who have plenty to eat, but not enough meaning in your life, for you are starving. You will be fed. The world says happiness means nothing bad ever happens to you. But Jesus, in the Becoming Saints manual, says, blessed are you who know what it is like to mourn the death of a husband, a sister, a relationship, a child, because you will love other people with a profound and real love exactly when they need it. The world says you have to be strong and powerful to be happy. But Jesus says, blessed are you who know you are a little messed up, a little afraid and unsure, and are willing to admit it, for your vulnerability is your strength. The world says to be happy, you have to have great hair and look good in a bathing suit. And in the Becoming Saints manual, the Beatitudes, Jesus says, blessed are you who love others exactly as they are, and who love yourself exactly as you are, for you will see God. The world says, seek revenge, return anger for anger, hurt those who hurt you. And Jesus says, in the Becoming Saints manual, blessed are you who love your enemies, for you will inherit the kingdom of God. The world says, win every fight. Show no mercy. Arm yourself with an arsenal of weapons so that you may protect you and yours. And Jesus in the Becoming Saints manual says, blessed are you who are merciful, for you will receive mercy. And blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. The Becoming Saints manual called the Beatitudes says, blessed are you. Jesus says, blessed are all of you. Be like Charlotte. Become saints. Charlotte Gildutis, blessed are you, good and faithful servant. Amen. Please, won't you pray with me? Dear God, whom we know as love, today we remember your beloved daughter, Charlotte Gildutis, whose life was particular and real and long on this earth. There is a thin and shimmering thread that connects us to the earth and to each other, even beyond the grave, to the saints, which is why we gather today. Help us to feel the presence of your grace now. Let us consider eternity as another possibility and name again Charlotte Gildutis' name as comfortable music in our mouths, tending as all music does towards silence. Let us consider eternity as another possibility. Let us be reminded, though it sounds impossible and miraculous, that life wins, that love triumphs even over death, that even the darkness of death can lead to the sunrise of morning, that even death does not have the final word because life carries on and carries us. Today we pray because we must grieve Charlotte's death, but we also pray in gratitude for her remarkably long life, a life that touched all of our lives. We pray most especially this morning for this family that love made, her two daughters, Gail and her husband Dana, Barbara and her husband Bill, four grandchildren, Dean and his partner Tina, Will and his wife Samantha, Danielle and her partner Brian, Chrissy and her partner Chris, four great grandchildren, Christian, Caitlin, Cameron, and Jaden, her beloved kitty Lucy, her dear cousins Roberta and Nancy, her dedicated caretaker Vivian, and many nieces and nephews. She joins the saints now in light, and the gates of heaven will be open to reveal her loving husband Ed and four sisters, Emily, Elizabeth, Patricia, and Margaret, waiting for her. God, surround this family with your healing and loving arms. Bring them comfort and courage. Remind them that their grief is holy, that their tears are testament to a life well lived. In the silence now, we lift up our prayers for healing and for wholeness. May light perpetual shine upon Charlotte Gildutis, and may her love continue long upon this earth. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please rise in body and spirit and sing with us our final hymn, How Great Thou Art. Thank you.
give you the grace never to sell yourself short, the grace to risk something big for something good, the grace to know that the world is now too dangerous for anything but love, and too scary for anything but truth. So may God take your mind and think through it. May God take your lips and speak through them. May God take your hearts and set them on fire. Amen. Thank you.